Good morning to you. Few people on vacation, huh? He is going to strike next week. Traffic, buses, oh my goodness. Well, we're glad that you're here this morning, and excited about talking about a scripture that I have never preached on before. I've sung it. I've reflected on it many times, and I just hope that this morning that God just opens your heart to this scripture in a new way. As I was thinking about this, you know, have you ever created a mess and tried to hide it? You know, whether it was getting something on your shirt and you're like, that didn't happen. And you're like, literally, you're like, you know, you're like doing the Pledge of Allegiance the rest of the day, or, you know, you're trying to hide in some way. You know, you made a mess on the floor and you pulled the rug over it. You know, well, why is the rug in a new place, you know? We've all had messes and things that we have created at times, and we've, you know, tried to save face. We've tried to do whatever we can to make it look like it really didn't happen. But the truth of the matter is, a lot of times, the consequences of that decision, like, come later, come back to haunt us at times. And then there's just the times when we were doing something we weren't supposed to and we got caught, okay? And have you ever gotten caught? The answer to that probably has been those pretty blue lights behind you, right? Aren't they nice? You know, there's lights behind you that you're like, okay, now it's time for you to contribute to the Fairfax County Beautification Fund, okay? You've gotten caught. It's all happened to us at one time or another. But do we try to save face? Do we try to cover it up? Or do we just own our mess? Do we just own it like, I did that, you know, and begin to move on from it? Or do we just cover things up? And Scripture says that men love darkness rather than light. And so our tendency is to try to save face. Our pride tries, you know, let's cover that up. Let's make it look like it didn't happen. But really, in essence, to move forward, we just need to own our mess. And so that's really the big idea this morning, is to own up to our sin and to move forward. So we're talking about David. And David, there's so many great attributes that we think of when we think of David, you know? I mean, he was a mighty warrior. He was a man after God's own heart. I mean, Scripture says this. So, in essence, sometimes we want to cover up the parts of his life that weren't all that pretty. But the reality is that Scripture gives us everything. And actually, I think it's so awesome that it does give us everything, because it gives us hope, because all of us have a little mess. All of us have things in our life that we're not all that proud of, but when we can see in Scripture where there's things that happen that weren't great, and God turns those things around, he interrupts you where you are, and interrupted David where he was at, and David received healing and moved on. He moved forward in his relationship with him. And so we're looking at David, and the scenario that you can read about later, we're not really covering it here other than mentioning it, was David should have been out with his troops. He was probably bored, okay? He was succumbing to temptation. How many of you have ever heard of HALT? Okay? Hungry, angry, lonely, tired. You know, when you're any of those things, you know, it's easy for us to fall into temptation when we run into those scenarios where we're hungry, we're angry, we're lonely, or we're tired. And so here's David. He was supposed to be with his troops, and he got up from his midday nap and was up on his roof, and he looks out, and he happens to see Bathsheba bathing, and he doesn't just like, oh my, you know, Lord help me, it's time to get on my knees, you know. I mean, he didn't do any of that. He lusted after her, but not just that. I mean, he called her, had her come to the palace, slept with her, and then he gets the call, I'm pregnant. And so he tries to cover this sin up. He tries to call her husband, who was a faithful man of character, called him from the battlefield, tried to get Uriah to sleep with his wife so that they could make this thing all go away. Because if that happened, then baby would come, not a big deal, and we could just move on like everything was good. But that isn't what happened. He couldn't get Uriah to sleep with his wife, and so here this troop who was loyal beyond loyal, David gives him a message to give to Joab. This is send him to the front line. So here he's carrying his death sentence, has no clue, gives the message to Joab, says, put him at the front lines and then withdraw. And Uriah is killed in battle. Problem solved, right? There was a lot to do to get there, but whoo, rug over the mess. We're good. We're out. And bring Bathsheba into the palace like it never happened. Life is good. Move on. But God doesn't allow us to stay there. And at the time, it may not feel great. None of us, you know, at the time, because of emotions that are running high, etc., you know, you're not looking for that moment. But God loves us so much that he brings us to places of pain so that we can have his supernatural surgery and move on. So that we can be healed and move on. And so there was a prophet named Nathan that told David a little story. And David basically was like, that story was like, that person, this needs to happen to them. This is a horrible situation. And Nathan says, you are that man. You are that man. And so through this process, there were consequences to what David had done. The son died. Murder was a constant threat in his family. His household rebelled against him. His wives were given to another in public view. If only he had known what would happen, the consequences of the sin. But God is so amazing at taking the mess of our life, and when we surrender to him, he turns it into something beautiful. All things work together for good for those who love God and are called according to his purpose. Romans 8:28, such a foundational verse for all of us, knowing that no matter what kind of mess you have, because we all got a mess, okay, in our rearview mirror, there's a mess, but God gives us hope for the future. And so here's where we are in Psalm 51, where David has owned it, and he's turning to God completely. And it's almost like we're reading his journal. It's almost like we're reading as he's writing down the pain and the turning of his heart. And so here we are, verse 1. Have mercy on me, O God, because of your unfailing love, because of your great compassion, blot out the stain of my sins. Wash me clean from my guilt. Purify me from my sin. For I recognize my rebellion. It haunts me day and night. Against you and you alone have I sinned. I have done what is evil in your sight. You will be proved right in what you say, and your judgment against me is just. For I was born a sinner, yes, from the moment my mother conceived me. But you desire honesty from the womb, teaching me wisdom even there. Purify me from my sins, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Oh, give me back my joy again. You have broken me. Now let me rejoice. Don't keep looking at my sins. Remove the stain of my guilt. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a loyal spirit within me. Do not banish me from your presence, and don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and make me willing to obey you. Then I will teach your ways to rebels, and they will return to you. Forgive me for shedding blood, O God who saves. Then I will joyfully sing of your forgiveness. Unseal my lips, O Lord, that my mouth may praise you. You do not desire a sacrifice, or I would offer one. You do not want a burnt offering. The sacrifice you desire is a broken spirit. You will not reject a broken spirit or a broken and repentant heart, O God. Heavenly Father, thank you so much this morning, Lord. Lord, for an account, God, that we can read. And Lord, if we allow your spirit, Lord, to penetrate our hearts this morning, God, we know that it can change everything. We love you this morning. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. What happens when we own up to our mess? These are four words that we're pulling out of this scripture that change everything. They changed everything for David, and four words that change us, and you kind of see them up front this morning. Four words that were prayed as we're reading David's account that really changed everything in David's life. The first word is wash. We've all got a stain at one point or another that we couldn't get out. Maybe you've done like I have before. You've got a stain on your clothes, and you're like, I'm not even going to try. Tied with color guard is not going to work. You know, and you throw it away. And there was a time when we were living with my parents, and my dad is like a master stain getter outer. Okay, I don't know how else to say it. Anyhow, he would get stains out of things, and so I remember literally hiding a shirt in the trash. And somehow my dad got that shirt out, and the next thing I knew, that shirt was clean and folded, and the stain was gone. I mean, this is my dad, right? I was trying to hide it because I didn't want to deal with it, and I didn't want him to find it. And sure enough, here that thing is folded, and it's like new, you know? Thank you, Dad. But we've all got stains. We've all got stains that we have made that have been a big deal. But what about a soul stain? What about a stain in your soul that you may be carrying this morning? Something in your heart that, you know, nobody can peek inside of you and see what's really going on. In fact, most of us are perfectly fine with you not being able to. Because when we look into the depth of who we are, there's things inside of us that we don't like. There's things inside of us that we're not proud of. It's a soul stain that we can only come to the Lord about. And David knew he had a stain that he couldn't get out. He was caught. He'd abused his power. He'd committed adultery. He'd lied. He'd murdered. And the list went on. This was not a small stain from a human perspective. It wasn't something that you could just, you know, get a little water and get it out. This was something that, if it wasn't dealt with, would have derailed him forever if it didn't receive healing. And so he prayed. Psalm 51:2, wash me clean from my guilt. Purify me from my sin. Verse 7 says, purify me from my sins and I will be clean. Wash me and I will be whiter than snow. Whiter than snow. Only God can clean this. You know, some of you are like, all this, okay? Only God can clean that. The inner part of your life, the places where you're afraid, the things in your heart that you know are not right. God's the only one that can wash that and make that whiter than snow. And the hope is still true for us today that no matter what kind of stains we have internally, it can be washed. No matter what you've done. This is a prime example. Okay, this was big. I mean, look, when you look at this, haven't you done like I have done and been like, oh, not that Bathsheba incident. You know? I mean, don't you just want to kind of, let's rip that part out. You know, just like we want to do in our lives sometimes, rip some things out and be like, it wasn't me. We want to do that. I've wanted to do that with this particular scripture, but it shows the grace and the mercy of God. It shows how powerful He is. It shows that no matter what we've done, He can wash us. He can make us clean, where we can be free. We come to church and we want to hide. A lot of us go to every aspect of our life, every area of our life, and we're hiding. And God's like, expose that so that I can wash it. I want to make it clean. I want to make it white. Own it so that you can move forward. Own it. Isaiah 1, 16 and 18 says, wash yourselves and be clean. Get your sins out of my sight. Give up your evil ways. Though your sins are like scarlet, I will make them as white as snow. Though they are like or red like crimson, I will make them as white as wool. And we have Paul in Acts 22, 16 say, what are you waiting for? I love this. What are you waiting for? Get up and be baptized. Have your sins washed away by calling on the name of the Lord. Maybe this is a word that you needed to hear this morning. Wash. Maybe that's your word because you think there's no way. And God says, way. There's a way to wash you. That soul stain, that thing that you hide behind all the time, you try to cover that up, I can wash that. That's what God says today. Four words that changed everything. The next one here is create. We all have someone in our lives who's very creative. When I think of creative people, Desiree Henderson comes right off my lips. She's the one who wrote these this morning. If I would have wrote those would not have been creative. I don't know if there's a word for them. What I would have created. Creativeness, bringing something out of nothing. To make something where it currently does not exist. To shape and to form. David knew his heart was in trouble. In his current state, it was a complete mess. He was like a ship that had gotten way off course. And so Psalm 51:10 says, create in me a clean heart, O God. We're born with this sin nature, and he called it. It's in this psalm. Born with a sin nature, but God creates something new in our lives when we surrender to him. Jeremiah warns us about our hearts. Jeremiah 17:9 says, the human heart is the most deceitful of all things and desperately wicked. Who really knows how bad it is? In other words, it's really bad. Who really knows? Because there's like things like lurking in there and stuff. And you've all experienced it. You're living life and you're good. Oh, I'm good. And all of a sudden a desire or a thought pops in there. And you're like, whoa, wait a minute. I mean, we could have our own Inside Out movie. I mean, couldn't we? Like things inside of us that you're just like, whoa, wasn't anticipating that. That thought, that feeling, etc. The enemy loves to play with those things, and the damage we do to our soul is hard to measure. Sometimes we can do a lot of damage in a very short time. We can't even figure out how we got here. Everything was good last week. Ha ha, Monday. What happened? Short amount of time. As a staff, we're reading a book called Soul Keeping by John Orberg, and we're learning to be keepers of our soul, that we're the ones that have been entrusted as the soul keepers. Proverbs 4:23 says, guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. Create in me a clean heart, God. One that longs and desires after you, knowing you, God, and knowing your will. It's in Ezekiel where it talks about God giving us a heart of flesh, a new heart, and that's the hope that we have as believers in Christ, that even though this thing that we have is desperately wicked, that God, by his Spirit, places new desires in us. And there are things that David never could experience because it wasn't the time, that you and I can today, because we have the Holy Spirit with us in an intensified way where he's with us all the time. It's not situational, but the Holy Spirit is with us, helping us to make right decisions, and that when we're tempted, we can guard our heart and flee the enemy. Sometimes we think, is it possible for God to create something? Someone say, duh. Right? Who are we talking about here? Right? We are talking about the creator of everything that has existed. Genesis 1:1-2. In the beginning, God created. Somebody say it with me. God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and empty, and the darkness covered the deep waters. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters. Hebrews 11:3. By faith we understand that the entire universe was formed at whose command? God's command, that what we now see did not come from anything that can be seen. Hello, McFly. Seriously. Created out of nothing that we have seen. God creates out of nothing. Can God create a clean heart in you this morning? Can he create a clean heart in me? We know the answer. The truth of God's word. David's prayer, create in me a clean heart. Creator of the universe, if there's anyone who can create in me a clean heart this morning, God, you can. You can create where there doesn't seem to be any feeling, any passion. God, you can create this morning. In you and me. Lord, give me desires that are pure. Give me a clean heart. Take away my selfish motives, my greed, my lust for the wrong things. Make this heart clean. Maybe that's your prayer today. This was a journal entry that I had on the 14th of this month. here's my heart, Lord, expecting you in the silence this morning. Guide my thoughts. You are great, and I want to know you and experience you in a fresh way. Forgive me for my wanderings. I am prone to wander, but you bring me back. I'm setting my heart, my affections on you this morning, my God. Lead me in your ways. Give me a wise and understanding heart, for without you, I am a lifeless shell of insecurity and fear. Help me to be confident in who I am in you. I am a mighty warrior in you. Give me courage today to follow you with obedience. I choose to trust you. Create in me a clean heart. This never goes away. It's a daily prayer. Lord, do what you want in me today. Create in me a clean heart today. Give me your desires. Another word that we'll look at is renew. So we've talked about wash. Can wash anything. We've talked about creating a clean space in you. And now we're talking about renewing. Has your team ever had a bad season? Are you trying to cover up the bad seasons? The truth is, every team has a bad season. Every team has seasons. You know, being a Seahawk fan since 1976, there were some seasons that I can't remember on purpose. We all have bad seasons as well. And here is such an interesting thing on David's life, okay? David had a bad season here. He had a bad season. Some of you are living a bad season right now. Some of you came out of a bad season and you're winning the Super Bowl, and that's awesome. But David had a bad season, and it's so good for us to be able to look at this and recognize that there are seasons of life that you may not be so proud of, but you can come out of the bad seasons. I mean, this was David. This was David. A man after God's own heart. I mean, he was chosen because he was a man after God's own heart. But his power went to his head. David had started off loyal to the Lord. He was loyal to God. Something like 20 years between him being anointed king and becoming king. King of Judah and then king of all over Israel. It took a long time. This was a man after God's own heart. You and I, we would have been like, I'm out. This thing is just not happening. But David was loyal to God through thick and thin. Through everything that happened, he was loyal. Through Saul trying to kill him. Hello? Throwing a spear at him. David had opportunities to kill the king. He was right there. He could have said, God has put him in my hands. I've got him. He was loyal, but he entered a bad season of his life where his power went to his head, he'd lost vision for the future, and the enemy was waiting for that opportunity. And so David's prayer was to renew. When you think of renew, you're thinking of make new again. Psalm 51:10, renew a loyal spirit within me. See, I had it. Make it new again, God. Renew that spirit within me. And the truth is, our God is able to renew us. Psalm 119:40, I long to obey your commandments. Renew my life with your goodness. 2 Corinthians 4:16, though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. There is a renewing that can happen in our lives. Maybe you had a loyal spirit to God, but you've gotten off track today. And maybe the word for you today is renew. God, renew a loyal spirit within me. I've gotten off track. I didn't anticipate being here, but this is where I am, God. But I hear you calling me this morning. And Lord, that's my prayer. Renew a loyal spirit within me. The last word we'll look at here is restore. To restore is to bring back. David's prayer was, God, bring back my joy in you. The joy that you have saved me, that you're with me, bring it back. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and make me willing to obey you. I love the brutal honesty of David. I love it, being able to see it. It should refresh all of us today to recognize this is David praying these things. You're not alone in your off feelings, because our feelings lie. Our God restores. Jeremiah 15:19, if you return to me, I will restore you so you can continue to serve me. 1 Peter 5:10, in his kindness, God called you to share in his eternal glory by means of Christ Jesus. So after you have suffered a little while, he will restore, support, and strengthen you, and he will place you on a firm foundation. To bring back. Some of you in this room had a joy that was so unexplainable when you first came to the Lord. You can remember that moment. You can remember God's presence. You can think back to the moment where you were freed, where God freed you mentally, where things were different. And you were saying yes to the Lord no matter what he would ask you to do. And some of you today have lost that joy. You can think back to that moment. I can think back to being, and I wasn't at an altar. I was out there, all right? And I just had my hands raised to God, just weeping. So grateful. Everything's different. I can remember the songs. I can remember Lenny Burdick. I want to be where you are, dwelling in your presence. Man. Some of you know it. And surrounded by your glory in your presence. That's where I always long to be. I just want to be. I just want to be with you. Remember just weeping. So grateful for the freedom that God had brought to my life. And that's the joy that the Lord wants to renew, or restore, rather, in you and us together. So what's your mess today? You know, we can try to hide our mess, or we can own it today. And I think a lot of times we fear rejection. We fear rejection. And we've all hid stuff from us. Maybe you broke something before. Maybe. And you threw it away hoping no one would find it. What happened to blank? I don't know. We fear rejection. What's going to happen if I offer all of my mess to God? But what does God really want? What does he really want from us? We get to peek into it in Psalm 51, verses 16 and 17. You do not desire a sacrifice, or I would offer one. You do not want a burnt offering. The sacrifice you desire is a broken spirit. You will not reject a broken spirit. I just keep adding a word in there, don't I? The sacrifice you desire is a broken spirit. You do not reject a broken and repentant heart, O God. God will not reject you coming to him. Aren't you grateful? We've all had bosses in our lives or whatever that you're like, you're sweating bullets because you've done something and you're like, bringing it, all right? And you know this is not going to be good. And here God is saying, I love you. Own that mess so that you can move forward. Own it. See, God is not looking for rituals. He's not looking for our lip service. He's not looking for our church attendance. He's not looking for our baby dedications. He's not looking for church membership. He is looking for hearts that long for him, that long for his presence. So we have these four words up here today. I'm grateful they all stayed up. I don't know which word today represents where you are, but I know there's a loving Savior today who longs for a relationship with you. That if you will confess your sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive you of your sins and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. That's our God. You do not have to fear rejection because he will not despise a broken spirit and a heart that says, God, I'm a mess. I own it. Forgive me. Heal me. So I don't know what word it is. I'm going to have the worship band come back. And here's what we want to do this morning is four words that changed everything. Took a bad season, something that could have completely derailed David. I mean, if he would not have owned that, if we didn't have Psalm 51, David would have been a speed bump in the Bible. We would have rolled right over it. Next king, because God is looking for hearts that long for him. And so do you long for the Lord today? Will you offer your life to him? So we're going to create a little bit of space here to make things right with God. Remember, he can wash any stain. any stain. It doesn't matter how bad you think your stain is. He can wash it all. And so maybe this morning you're saying, Lord, wash me clean from my guilt. Maybe that's where you need to be today. Maybe it's creating me a clean heart. Maybe it's renew a loyal spirit within me. Or maybe it's restore the joy of my salvation because I lost it. We're believing that the Lord is going to answer those prayers today. But I want to challenge you, respond. Respond. Let's stand up. As we enter into this time of worship, I challenge you to come find your word. Come find your word. What is it today? Wash, create, renew, restore. What is the word that you know that God has for you today? The staff are going to be down here to pray with you, asking God to confirm that in your heart and to bring the healing as we own our messes together. Heavenly Father, we offer this time to you today. Bring healing to hearts, we pray, as we have the courage to obey. In Jesus' name, amen.
We bend our knees. O Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. O Lord, we cast down our idols. Give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. We bow our hearts, we bend our knees. O Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. O Lord, we cast down our idols. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, oh Lord. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands. Give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Oh, seeks your face, seek your face. I give it all to you. Lay it all down. You, my King, worthy of all praise, worthy of my soul. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, oh Lord. Let us not lift our souls to another. God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, God of Jacob. I surrender I surrender all to you. It's a new song that God has just put in our hearts right now. Just in a sign of surrender, can we just lift our hands to our God? We give it all to you, Lord. You are worthy. Sing it with me. I surrender, surrender all to you. I surrender, I surrender all to you. I surrender, I surrender all to you. I surrender, I surrender all to you. I surrender all to you. I surrender all to you, all to you, King of Kings, worthy of all our praise, all to you. King of Kings, worthy of all praise. I surrender all to you. I surrender.